Namaskar. On behalf of ICMC, Indian Classical Music Circle, let me welcome you all to today's episode, remembering Pandit Ravi Shankar Ji. Tomorrow is 7th April, Pandit Ji's birthday. So ICMC is extremely, extremely fortunate and honored to host this event today. And we are privileged to have one of the prime disciples and sitar maestro, Pandit Gaurav Mazumdar Ji, with us. On behalf of ICMC and all its viewers, let me welcome to you, Dada. I am extremely grateful to you for agreeing to join this program, this online broadcast program in memory of Pandit Ji. Thank you so much, Dada. Pranam.
My blessings to you, Ram. Thank you very much for the wonderful work you're doing. Thanks for inviting me and celebrating my guru, Bharat Ratna Pandit Ravi Shankar Ji's 104th birth anniversary.
What a great start with the meditative and introspective tone of sitar. Probably his music speaks for himself. And for all of us, the music fraternity, Indian music fraternity, it is because of him, the world knows Indian classical music because of his work and the way he spread the music throughout the globe and his vision, pioneering vision. The entire music fraternity is grateful to him, to the eternity, because of his music, his work, the way he has spread the music throughout the world. So, Radha, if I can request you to share your first musical memories. I know you had already a musical background in your family. Your father was a musician. You have got lessons from him, Pandit Dulal Mazumdar Ji, your uncle J.D. Mazumdar Ji, your cousins Kamala Bose Ji and Jayashree Roy Ji. From all of them, you have got initial musical ideas and lessons. But when you listened to Pandit Ji, what was your first musical memories, if you could share with us, and what was your impression?
I would like to take all of you a little back, much before I was born, because that's when there was this divine connection between my family and Baba Alauddin Khan Sahab and Pandit Ravi Shankar Ji, Annapurna Ji, Ali Akbar Khan Sahab. So my journey really started with Pandit Ji, with Guruji, much before I was born. I come from a family which was very steeped in music, dedicated to music from Allahabad. My grandfather came to Allahabad to work and he stayed back in Allahabad. After that, both my parents, they were born in Allahabad. I was born in Allahabad. I grew up in Allahabad. And Maihar being just very close to Allahabad and being a very small village those days in the early 1900s, Allahabad was the main place to come to for whatever, whether you have to take a train to go to Calcutta or to Bombay or to the rest of the country, or if you want to go to the All India Radio to Lucknow first and then Allahabad later, or to come for the Allahabad Music Conference, one of the biggest conference in India, where most of the stalwarts we know, they did their debut, they started performing there. Professor Bhattacharya, chemistry professor, he did this music conference, which would run for days and weeks, and musicians would live there in tents and perform. And any time of the day, night, you go there, somebody would be performing, be it Abdul Karim Khasab or Ustad Bade Ghulam Ali Khasab or Baba Alauddin Khasab. Talking of that kind of stature of musicians, then coming to my Guruji and Ali Akbar Khan Sahab and Vilayat Khan Sahab, all these people, Ustad Inayat Khan Sahab also, one of his last performance was at the Allahabad Music Conference after, before his unfortunate demise. So my family was very close to Baba. Baba used to come and live in our home and considered our home. He used to call my Dida Bhagavati Devi, and my parents, my uncles, they all benefited a great deal from the presence of Baba in our family. And Baba started teaching my uncle. My uncle, Shri Nalin Mazumdarji, was one of the pioneers in introducing slide guitar to Indian music, and one of the first Gandaband Shagirds of Ustad Ali Akbar Khan Sahab. So I heard a lot of stories right from my birth about Guruji and Ali Akbar Khan Sahab, Baba, Nikhil Banerjee, Annapurna Devi ji would stay for days and weeks in our home practice. And so this home was like their own home, and we had their blessings. My first interaction with Guruji's music was way back in 1979. Where he had come for my uncle Dalin Mazumdar ji's organization Jhankar. We had a music school called Mazumdar School of Music and another one by my uncle Jhankar Music. For Jhankar, Guruji came to play for Jhankar's one of the anniversaries in 1979 with Pandit Kishan Maharaj ji and my very dear senior Guru Bhai Deepak Chaudhary. And I still remember going there as a child, as a, you know, I was into my early teens then. Really, no idea of what the greatness of this music is all about. And that was the first time I heard Guruji playing Raag Bihag. I still remember he played with Kishan Maharaj, Bihag, Alap Jod Jhala and Dhamar. But
sorry to interrupt. So your first exposure to his music was not through recording, through live concert itself?
Never. I unfortunately, by the time I was born and I started learning music, there was not much of listening happening at home other than learning. So I didn't have access to a long playing, or little later when cassettes start coming. CD was much later. So I really didn't have any experience of Guruji's music. So that was the first time I heard him. And I cannot speak much about it because I was too young and I was too, what can I say, to understand his music and to analyze his music. And then later in the 80s, when I was in my college final, Guruji came to Allahabad again for Jhankar this time. And by then I was a singer initially. And I learned to sing for many, many, many years. I would sing for All India Radio. I got first position in the competitions. From very young age, from the age of 3 and 4, I would sing on stage. And later, my father put me onto the violin because my eldest uncle, who was instrumental in bringing music to our family, was a violinist. So my father thought that would be a nice way to keep the tradition. So you'll be surprised to know that in mid-80s, when Guruji came again for Jhankar's Silver Jubilee, Guruji heard me play the violin. So I wasn't a sitar player. I had no idea that I would be playing the sitar one day. So Guruji heard me, and the day I played for him in the morning, the same evening he had a concert in Allahabad for Jhankar, and I went and heard him. This time he played Puriya Kalyan, and he played a Jhaptal because I played a Jhaptal in Rag Bhairav in the morning.
Okay, so tentatively, which year it
1985.
85 itself. Okay.
1985, 27 November. So, he played and I heard him, but I was too shy to go after the concert and meet him. I was standing outside the green room. Nobody invited me inside. Nobody. So I left. And after a few months, my uncle heard from Guruji saying that, and Guruji asked me after I played, he said, you need Talim. And, you know, I have just started a Gurukul in Delhi. Would it be possible if I accept you as a disciple, would you like to come and stay there? So that time I was finishing college, and by then I had already decided I wanted to do music. I was really very deep into music, and I did say yes, in a very hesitant way, really, because I wasn't sure that I was going to be accepted or what it means to be with Guruji. I could understand how great he was, who he was.
And his heart was so big that generally for this maestros of this stature, generally people run after them. But you were so privileged, and obviously you had the quality within that great maestro.
I won't say I had the quality. I would say I was blessed to be born in a family of the Mazumdars who were so close to Guruji. And I was lucky that I met Guruji, who always wanted to teach. Teaching was his passion. So I take no credit for whatever happened. So Guruji spoke to my uncle. And when I finished St. Joseph's, I enrolled in the university for English honors. And when Guruji called, I left everything. And I went with a promise to my father that I will continue my graduation online. By post. That time there was no online correspondence, it used to be called, and they would send regularly in a packet, which I never opened. It still kept somewhere unopened. So when I went to Guruji, and that's when, Ram, I first felt his greatness. July of 1986, when I entered his home and I smelt the Agarbatti, I embraced the aura of the home. And then when I met him, and that same day he sat for the session, he didn't even wait. He sat straight away that same day I arrived in Delhi. And I still remember he taught me Shyam Kalyan. And that's when it really hit me where I am and with whom I am. And that's my first experience with his music, not the Behag, not the Puriya Kalyan. My first experience with his music was in his puja room, him and me alone, me on the violin, he on the sitar, teaching Ektal, a bandish in Shyam Kalyan, and before that a lendi, chalan and alap, and going into the depths of how in our gharana we approach a rag. So that's my first experience with his music, really.
Great. And so you started to learn violin with him under his tutelage, under his guidance. When you actually shifted to sitar, was it his inspiration, or was it it's your call of heart?
So I had played 12 years violin. I had already started performing. I was playing for radio and all that. But Ram, coming to him and sitting with him and hearing the growl on his sitar, his kharaj, his pancham, his madhyam, the techniques of the sitar, I think, without knowing, I fell in love with the sitar. I fell in love with the baj of the baj of Guruji. And it really created a deep conflict within me. Because here I was in my late teens. It was not very early. People by my age would already start performing if I have taken it up as a profession. I come from a middle-class family, and obviously, you know, we don't have much to fall back on other than the family's reputation and music. Yeah. But music, if I start at late teens, to stop an instrument I have played for about 12 years and start from scratch. It's a big, big thing. But for me, that desire within me to learn the sitar kept growing. And I gave myself, without thinking about it, I gave myself almost a year. From 1986 to 1987, I dwelled in that conflict. I started to question and answer myself. Why do I want to do it? What are the repercussions? If I take it up, what will be my way to approach it? How much I have to put time into it? Everything. And after a year, when the desire was so huge, I decided to approach him, because that and fortunately or unfortunately, I didn't speak about it to anybody, because the last thing I wanted to speak to somebody who doesn't understand what I'm going through within and tells me, no, it's a wrong decision.
Right.
At this age, forget about it, continue with the violin. That's an answer I didn't want. I wanted somebody to feel what I'm feeling, and then answer. And if they said no, continue violin, I would have listened to them. But I knew people will not, nobody will understand this.
Listen to your point with empathy.
And what I'm feeling about the music, what I'm feeling about Guruji, what I'm feeling about the sitar, only I can feel. So I dwelled on that. And luckily, from 1986 onwards, Guruji was a member of Rajya Sabha. So he had to spend a large chunk of time in Delhi. And that's the year I went, and I stayed 7 years with him. Out of this 6 years, he was member. So I got a lot of time with him and living with him in Delhi, where I was staying. So this was summer of 1987. By then, I had reached the peak of my sort of a saturation that, okay, decide now. And the decision is sitar. And I was so desperate that I had started to even think that if Guruji says no, who do I go to? Mm. And to tell you the truth, for you to make you understand about how desperate I was, even if I was hearing a beginner, I would think, okay, I'll go to this person and learn. At least they can teach me Saregama. If Guruji says, okay, you have gone crazy, this is a crazy thing, go back home, I'm not teaching you. Anybody I would listen to, I would say, okay, this person. That was the level of my desperateness.
So probably Panditji was the first person to whom you have revealed your thought. Is it so? Or
yes, yeah. Yes. So, Guruji was one person. There was another person. I have a dear Guru Bhai, Parimal Sadafal. And another person who unfortunately is no more with us is Sanjay Guha. Deepak Das, very, very, very senior disciple. But they all come later into the picture. Later, same time. So it was a summer afternoon and we had lunch, and it was only those days amongst the five disciples who were staying. I was alone with Guruji and Parthoda was there. Partho Sharathi Saro. Only two of us and Guruji, only three people in the house. Imagine staying with him for months like that. So I decided, okay. So we had lunch. And after lunch, Guruji said, you know, it's very rare that in summer months I'm in India. I would like to have mangoes.
No.
So I volunteered. And anyway, you know, the home front, I was looking after many things. So I said, I'll go and get the best mangoes for you. Which ones you want, I'll bring variety. And because I wanted to have that time to go out of the house, because my plan before, I had thought, okay, now the time has come to tell Guruji. My problem was, if I start telling him and I fumble, my thoughts get diluted, or I come into some sort of a grip of fear. How do I explain what I'm going through? So I wrote a letter to him. I rewrote the letter, drafted it. And that day when finally I thought, okay, everything I'm feeling has been expressed in this letter, I went and made a photocopy. That after giving the letter, if he accepts me, this letter, copy of this letter, I will need one day for my, you know. So I kept the copy, and when I was going to get the mangoes, I gave him the letter, and he thought there's some mail which has come. He says, what is it, open? I said, no, Guruji, this is from me to you. I want you to read it. So Guruji got a little flustered, because I think what he thought was that after staying 1 year, I'm missing my family. And I'm done with really, I want to go back. Right. So Guruji then said, he says, no, you know what? Just push yourself. It happened to me also when I went to Mahir. I really went through a struggle within myself because I was with Dada. I had all the luxury and then staying in Mahir. It happened, but I stayed on and look what has happened to me. Stay back. I promise you that you will. So I said, no, Guruji, that's not the point. There's something else in this letter I need to reveal to you. I want you to read it. So I left. I gave the letter, touched his feet, and I left. I came back after maybe 2 hours, longest time I took to buy mangoes. The shop was just, I was 10 minutes away, but I brought. When I came back, he had already gone to rest. Because after food, he would sit down and read. And he would read lots of newspapers and magazines and books. And then he would rest for about 40, 45 minutes. Yes. So he had gone to rest. I quietly went and I went inside and I was sitting. And then there was a power cut. And as soon as the power cut was there, I heard Guruji's door open. And Guruji used to walk in a way that his slip-ons, the chappal he used to wear, it used to go against the floor and make a certain sound. And I knew that sound is Guruji's sound. So I knew he's out of his room, but I didn't go. Usually I would run and go and ask if he needs anything. I didn't. So Parthoda went. And I heard them talking there. Guruji was talking to him and I stayed inside and I didn't know whether he's talking about me, about the letter or something. Anyway, after some time, he really gave a very loud shout, Gaurav. And I was with a lot of fear in my, I went there and I went and I touched his feet again. I said, he says, you brought the mangoes? I said, yeah. He says, this power cut, I hope it doesn't last very long. I said, no, usually it comes soon, Guruji, it will be. And then he says, "Toma chithi ami porlam Bangla." He would always talk to me in Bengali. All the letters he has written to me is in chaste Bengali, not a word of English in it. And whenever he spoke to me, it was only Bengali. So, "Toma chithi porlam ami," I read your letter. His tone was a little stern. So I wasn't sure how to place it. Is it a yes? Is it a no? And then he says, he used to call, he never said gadha or anything. He used to say ghoda. That was his way of telling that you're stupid. So he said, ghoda, you've been suffering for 1 year. Tumi aage bolo ni keno amake? Why did you not? You wasted a year. We could have done so much work in it. And it was a Monday, Ram. He says, kalke Mongolbar, Tuesday, it's a good day, Hanumanji's day. Get up in the morning. And he always liked us to get up early, have a bath, wear fresh clothes every day. Washed clothes. Fresh means washed. So, says, toiri hoye thakbe. And next day, Tuesday, with his sitar, his mijra, my lesson started on the sitar.
Oh, wow.
So,
that's like a fairy tale.
That's today, when I look back, it's really like a fairy tale that really did it happen? Did I stay with him? Did I learn from this great man? And how kind he was, how wonderful he was.
My father had some interaction with him because of his tutelage and association with Pandit Indranil Bhattacharya. My father is one of the senior most disciples of Pandit Indranil Bhattacharya. So from him I heard. So whenever Pandit used to talk in Bengali, there was not a single English word.
Never.
And whenever he used to talk in English, there was no other language. So he was so meticulous.
Same with French also. Whenever he spoke, because he went to school in Paris, so his French was very, very fluent. So whenever he spoke, whenever he was in France or he was meeting some French people, he always spoke in French.
Mm-hmm. Oh. So this, I think this daily episode of his life was much after this Banaras. Like in Banaras, he had Rimpa and
all the setup.
So it was after that.
So you know the story that Guruji was born in Banaras.
Yes.
Yeah. He used to, and he never called it Banaras or Varanasi. He always called it Kashi.
Kashi.
Always. He used to call it Kashi. Guruji was born in Kashi. And as a result, like all of us, Ram, I have a special place in my heart for Allahabad. Guruji loved Kashi. Guruji loved Varanasi. So he always wanted, and he had a very, very close connect with his mother.
He loved
his mother. He was very close to his mother. So he wanted to do something in Banaras. He wanted to do something in Varanasi. So in the 70s, when he was basically after this whole explosion and him being a super star of music, a global icon, he always looked forward to coming back to India and going back to places like Varanasi and all, and go into a quiet room to his practice and teaching disciples. He always loved that. And he, from the very beginning of his life, he has always given a lot of time to his disciples. But only twice, once in the beginning, when he left Mahir, went to Bombay, there were some disciples staying with him. And then later, last part, it is in his life, when there were this few disciples who lived with him. I was fortunate to be one of them. These are the times when people stayed with him. Other than that, people would come and go, but there were always disciples around. He would always love to teach. So Guruji wanted to build something like a ashram, like a Gurukul. And Banaras Gurukul. Was right. Himangana, in his mother's name, Himangani Devi. He built a beautiful, you enter that place and you feel you have come to heaven. That wow. was the feeling I got when I first went to Varanasi in 1986, December. You felt that you have been transported to a place where there is just music, music and music. Beautiful place. So he built that place way back in 70s, and he had it till almost early 90s. And he would go there, stay there for 15 days, 20 days, have master classes, practice, and then he would have those Rimpa festivals, long 7 days, 8 days. Every musician of this country has come and performed there. So this was his, I think, retreat. This was his connect with himself, his childhood. And this was his way of going back to his mother.
Wow. This is amazing. Like, even after being such a global superstar, he never forgot his root and the never, intention.
Never. I always saw Guruji as a person, a traditional Bengali person with a dhoti and kurta, eating maj bhat and loving his Bengali books. Amake regular Dilli tami Siyad Park jetam to bring Desh and Ananda Bajar and all that, and he would love reading them, and it was amazing that this man was who he was. In a traditional setting he would be so traditional, in a modern setting he would be so contemporary, so modern. And he can talk to you about just about anything. You just choose
any subject.
Any subject, and he would be there. He would just, you will be surprised. I mean, once my cousin who is into printing, and you know, he's a journalist, and he came to meet him, and he was asking him questions like, even he didn't, from his field. You know, there used to be this Kalki magazine in Kerala, and there used to be this publisher called this person, and this. He says, my God, you know. I said, yeah, that's who he is. That's who this man is. And that's why he is who he is, you know.
We are getting some comments from our viewers. Sara Kumar has
Sara mentioned. Sara is a dear friend of mine in Paris. And I know Sara for a long, 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 long time. And Sara's father, Pramodji, was a very, very, very senior disciple of Guruji.
Right. Chandrimadi, Sarutlev from I think Delhi, she has written
also a very dear friend from Delhi, and from Shahjahanpur Gharana. She's a right. wonderful person and a Sarut player.
Right, from Narendra, she runs
here. Yeah, exactly.
So we have viewers from across the globe. Your disciple Ahir is watching us. He's sending some comments and greetings.
He's from Calcutta, and
Calcutta.
Very promising, and I hope he continues the tradition. And
yeah, Asim Chaudhary is watching us. So Dada, if you could just let us know which recording we should listen to before we go to next question.
Yeah, so I let you choose. I let you choose whatever you want to play, and then we can talk about it. I would like if you can play the Gath of Devgiri Bilawal here. Would
Devgiri Bilawal.
Gath of Parameshwari, his creation from 1960s. Let's listen to Devgiri Bilawal, which how beautifully in the traditional way, and he's played a Gath in Ektal in this.
Right. Yeah. Let's listen to that.
Thank you. Thank you.
What to say? Each music piece is diverse and different and full of so creativity. Dada, I have just muted you because there was some feedback coming. If you could unmute yourself before you speak, Dada.
This is beautiful. I would like you later after we speak, I would like you to run the till the end. It's very interesting.
Let's do that now. Then it will continue.
Yeah, just to show how elaborate a beautiful rag like Devgiri, how he has gone into bringing it into an LP. This is a very great how great his editing sense of editing was.
Let's continue. Thank you.
I still remember 1997, we were coming back after a concert from Los Angeles. And we listened to this. He usually didn't like a lot to listen to himself. But that day, somehow it was in the car. We were coming back and we heard this and we were reaching. And 97, he was 79 years old. And I remember at this very sum, I don't know how it happened, we reached home in San Diego. And, and he did that and he says, you know, I have to practice. And we went and then we sat for about an hour before going to bed. We played Yaman. It's just amazing, amazing. Yeah.
Indeed. As you were saying a little earlier, the musical content or ideas or vision which he learned from his gurus, particularly Baba Alauddin Khan Sahab, and on top of that, any great musician we have seen, they add their own thought, own vision, own ideas in their creative process and make a different product altogether, which is they bring in front of the world as a very unique thing, as their signature. So what do you think regarding Panditji's music, like the talim that he got, diverse talim he got from Baba Alauddin Khan Sahab, and what are the ingredients he added of his own and made this so unique baj on sitar? See, and what were his inspirations? What were his inspirations?
I strongly believe, you know, when it comes to Guruji, when people speak about him, obviously it's true. I'm not saying it's not true that he took this music to every corner of the world. But I always like to add something, and I will go back from there, then it will explain you who he was and why he was able to do on the sitar. This is just in relation to sitar. I'll narrow it down to. But first, from Maihar, the first thing he did was to bring our music to every part of our country. He was one person who started the music circles in every possible small cities. He would, any place, even my uncle remembers that he saw my uncle's terrace. And the first thing he says, you know, this is a good place for a workshop, sure, or talking to students or doing a baithak. And next time I come, you know, or if anybody is coming, I'll let you know. So Nikhil Kaka was coming to Allahabad, and Guruji sent a telegram to my uncle that he's coming. Tumi ore ekta bajna rakho. So he took this music to every corner of India, and he was a superstar in India before he became a global superstar. His halls were always full. People would always go back. He was a superstar in India before he left India in 1956. The second time as a sitar player, the first time with his brother in 1930s, early 30s as a dancer. So that was one. He going to Baba, imagine the scenario that the peak of World War or the beginning of the World War, and here this man is trying to go to a village in Maihar and dedicate his time to basically a peaceful atmosphere of music. That's the backdrop where Guruji finally left everything, his glamour and glitter and a dancer and a musician in his brother's troupe, traveling all over the world, playing in, whether you talk of the Symphony Hall here in Chicago or the Carnegie Hall or Albert Hall, all these places. Uday Shankarji, according to Guruji, was the first global superstar, and he has not seen anybody as big as his brother. That was to have empresarios then, to have managers, to perform in the best of halls, to all the Hollywood stars coming to meet Uday Shankarji. So Guruji saw that as a child.
Sure.
And he was born in Benares, in this city where you hear the bells of the temple. You hear his mother singing Rabindra Sangeet, or his cousins. He grew up in that, and then by early 30s, he started to see Italy, he started to see London, he started to see New York. Empire State Building was just built when he first landed by boat from Europe when he came to New York. That's the time we are talking about. He came to Chicago. I still remember my first visit with him to Chicago, and he showed us the Congress Hotel where they stayed.
Oh.
So we cannot take away those influences, those impressions as a child, what he got, his mother, his cousins, his brother, and then traveling and hearing Pablo Casal, hearing Yudi Menuhin in his teens, practicing and playing and hearing the best symphonies and meeting the best ballet dancers. Guruji was a global icon even before he stepped into the world of the sitar full time, because he was already playing sitar in his brother's troupe.
So I think in Uday Shankarji's troupe also there were several musicians there also. He got exposure to that sound, Indian sound.
As much as his taleem started with Baba Alauddin Khasab in Uday Shankarji's troupe, he formally didn't learn from anybody. But of course, those influences were all the Vishnudas Shiraliji was there, Timir Baranji was there, and so many other musicians in the group were there, obviously. He got the influences of Kathakali, he got the influences of Bharatnatyam, he got the influences of all the art forms.
I don't know whether, because in his Rag Anurag, the book, his autobiography, he mentioned, first he decided, his thought came in his mind that I will learn sitar after listening to Bhombol Babu Amiyokanti Bhattacharya when he was taking talim from Enath Kansab.
Yes.
In Shiptapalem.
And it was also, home of Timidwar, it was also planned to go and tie Ganda and start learning from Enath Khasab.
And that comes out, right.
As a stroke of destiny or whatever, you know, I truly believe, and Guruji always believed in this. He used to always say, amader shob golpota age theke hoye ache. So jeta hobar seta hobe. So I strongly believe that he was to go to Baba, because from the time he saw Baba, and every time he has spoken about Baba to us, he would only say that nobody in the music world, nobody has influenced me so much, had so much impact on me than what Baba had. And he would talk about Baba as Baba was God. If Baba was in the room, Guruji will never sit. Or even if he's in the other room and he's walking past and Guruji is sitting with few people talking or whatever, Guruji will stand up. He never spoke to Baba on the phone sitting down. He had great, at wherever Guruji would be, in his sitar box with his strings, Baba's picture was there. In his puja room, Baba was there. Without Baba and without Uday Shankarji, these were his two great gurus. And he always said that. He always said that. So once Baba came on board, for a very short time, and the influence Baba had on him, and his zeal then to go back to India, because Baba told him that you're doing everything, you're playing sitar and you're dancing and you're choreographing and you're doing, if you want to really do something, you have to leave everything and decide on one thing and do that well. And wow, that mantra stayed with Guruji. And when the time came, when he was thinking about it in his mid-teens, he really got this desire to leave everything, go to Mahir and live with Baba. So he shaved his head, and the story everybody knows, I don't need to repeat. Then he went to Mahir and he started his talim on the sitar. So now coming to a musician who was an ocean, Baba was an ocean. Guruji always, two things I always asked Baba's age. He said, you know, we believe that he lived way over 100 years, but how does it matter really whether he was 100 or 110 or 111 when he, what he achieved in his lifetime, people don't achieve in 300, 400, 500 years. So age is really, you know, it's not that important. And second thing, Baba learned so much from so many musicians. Guruji always explained this so beautifully that even though he learned from Wazir Khan Sahib, was his main guru, he learned, he tied Ganda and he learned the Dhrupad Binkar style. But before that, he learned from so many people that when Baba finally settled down in Mahir, he had this melting pot of knowledge. And from that, what came out, he gave it to his disciples. So naturally, the music was very, very different to what was heard before then. And his disciples obviously started calling it Mahir Gharana. So Guruji getting talim from Baba in the strict Dhrupad style and his influences, when Guruji was finally ready to perform his first concert in 1939 with Ali Akbar Khan Sahib Jugalbandi in Allahabad Music Conference, Guruji had so many ideas. He had already heard Yusuf Khan Sahib playing the Kharaj Pancham sitar. But his idea of the sitar, his idea of incorporating the bean, the surbahar on the sitar, came with his working hours and hours, sometimes 18, 20 hours a day, and speaking to Kanai Lal, speaking to Nodu Babu, to create his signature sitar, on which then he was able to express what was within him. And this took a long time. It didn't happen overnight. It didn't. And you hear Guruji's music from, if anybody has heard him in his 20s, in his 30s, every decade Guruji's music kept changing.
Changed, yeah. You all
every decade his music kept, because he was a highly creative man. You take two albums of his, of the same rag, and they are so very different. And that's one thing I have felt with him, that he didn't have a mold. Like most musicians would have a mold and they would pour the notes into it, whether it was Parameshwari or Bhairavi, and that mold would then create. No, he had one mold, he would put the rag and then he'll break the mold and throw it. And for the next rag, he would. So every rag had a different, distinct personality and they sounded very different.
I think of these three greats, as it is called, Brahma, Vishnu, Maheshwara of instrumental music, Pandit Ravi Shankarji, Ustad Ali Akbar Khan Sahib, Ustad Vilayat Khan Sahib, For them, I mean, you see the sitar tone for khansab also, each recording the tonal quality is different, approach to the rag is different one. So this diversity,
I would
the creativity, you
know, Ram, this, and this is my as a student of music, I'm just expressing, don't take that I'm any authority or anything, but when you sitar, I would like definitely to add the name of Pandit Balram Pathak ji to this list, and also Ustad Abdul Halim Zafar Khan sahab.
Abdul Halim Zafar Khan sahab.
Because they had such distinct
style.
And Nikhil Banerjee, they had such a distinct style of their own. And I'm sure it has not come in one day. They must have worked. You being a, you know, sitar player, you know what work it takes for you to first learn what is already there, and then to leave that aside and create something of your own. It doesn't happen overnight, or it doesn't happen at all.
Even if we just consider the sitar tonal quality, tonality, the distinct tone, once the chikari or taraf comes, then, oh, this is Panditji, this is Khansab, like that. So they first visualize that.
When you talk of tonality, this is my personal choice. I would like to add the name of Ustad Rais Khansab in that.
Rais Khansab.
Tone, any day, tone, clarity, technique, there's so much to take from that person, you know. So, I say without any hesitation, because this is just my study of the instrument, which has brought me here. And there is immense contribution from these people, you know.
Yeah. The uniqueness, even from the uniqueness of sound, with a simple joda chikari, we can get to know, okay, this is the signature tone of this great artist. If you could just share some memories of any concert or Panditji's interaction with any great contemporary maestros, maybe Ustad Ali Akbar Khan sahab or any other great tabla artist.
Many. I would like to mention, I don't know if that time you were in Calcutta or you were somewhere else, he played a concert, Guruji played a concert at Jora Shako, Thakur Badi.
Okay.
And this was in the 90s, and he got a very big award in Calcutta, and many, many great musicians, Gyan Babu and all these great musicians of Calcutta, they were all there, and Guruji played a beautiful first half with Kishan Maharaj Ji Dhamar. And I remember, because I had gone with him, and Guruji was staying in Baliganj with Lala Babu the house of
Lala Sridhar
Jirbadite. And Kishan Maharaji was also staying there. Kishan Maharaji was staying upstairs and Guruji was staying downstairs.
Both used to stay there.
Yeah. And we had stayed in Calcutta that trip for about a good, I think, a week, 10 days. And every day morning, every day evening, Guruji sat with Kishan Maharaj Ji.
Oh.
And every day it was Dhamar. Every day it was. I'll never forget that. And the first day they sat, and I remember Kishan Maharaj Ji started the theka and he stopped. And he told Guruji that, you remember our early days in Bombay, because Kishan Maharaj Ji also started his career from Bombay, like Guruji. So they were staying in Bombay, Guruji Ali Akbar Khan sahab and Kishan Maharaj Ji. So Guruji said, yes, of course I remember. He says, you remember we used to play this game of keeping some on different beats of Dhamar, instead of coming on one, deciding on 5 and 7 and 9 and 14. Let's do that today. And for about three and a half hours that day till lunch, they kept on doing that. The sum came on 5th or 7th or whatever. Kishan Maharaj Ji said, okay, now 9. Every tihai, everything. And what I liked so great about both their playing, whether it was Kishan Maharaj Ji, whether it was Guruji, when Guruji played Dhamar, it was as if somebody was playing the Rudra Veena on the sitar. There was no murki, no khayalang, there was no nothing from the style of vocal music where you don't do Dhrupad, Dhamar. It was steeped in that, and he would do different kind of, you know, ladis and todas and Kishan Maharaj Ji, you feel that somebody is really playing the pakhavaj on the tabla. Mm-hmm. And that was such a beautiful, for us it was like talim, sitting close hand in front and seeing just these two people. And the room was full, the room was packed as if a concert was going on. And everybody, Deepakda was there, and there were other so many musicians. Deepakda, I miss Deepakda so much because I consider Deepakda as one of my gurus, because I learned a lot from him. I would, all the time when Guruji was not in Delhi, Guruji would be traveling. If I was not traveling with Guruji, I would go to Calcutta and stay with Deepakda in Kalighat, 418. It was so this experience, and there is one more experience which I like to share with people all the time, because by the time I came to Guruji's life, Guruji was in his mid-60s. He was already, all this term superstar and all that was behind him. Mm-hmm. So he was onto a very different journey, a more delving deep into the music and trying to really know who he is, who's his mission and what he has done and what he would like to do. So when I came to him in 1986, I remember very clearly the television had really taken on the people of India. Mm-hmm. And there were these two very big serials, Ramayana and Mahabharata, in the morning time, where everything would come to standstill.
Right.
And evening, we had other serials also. And Guruji, as a person who was so aware of everything, Guruji would watch them. So there was a time when Guruji had a concert in Bombay for Gunida Sangeet Sammelan. Mm-hmm. And all the festivals, whether it was Gunida's, whether it was Doverland, he was playing in all those festivals. And the last day, last item would be Guruji. So Gunida's that day, that year, Guruji was finishing the festival with a morning concert. And his concert was on a Sunday. Mm-hmm. And Guruji was very worried that there'll be no audience, because everybody's so hooked to the television and around. So way back, say you go back 1 week from that day, we were in Delhi, we were planning, and Guruji said, "Tumi amar sathe cholo, we will stay in Joshi Puraji's house in Pedder Road." I was very excited, of course, going with Guruji. And before that, Shrikanto bole ekta serial asto tomar Sharad Babur Golpur opore. Mm-hmm. So he would watch that, and I would sometimes watch it with him. And Ramayana Mahabharata, I was watching in Allahabad. Coming to Delhi, of course, my routine went totally. So I had missed some. So Guruji said, "Aajke Shrikanto miss korte hobe, are also Sunday, this Sunday, a week to the concert. I don't think I'll be able to watch Ramayana Mahabharata." I said, I really had a big question mark. I said, "Guruji, apni to baditei achen. Why? You have to go?" He says, No. Amake reyaz korte hobe, concert ache amar." So I said, "Ha, concert ache, Guruji." I was thinking to myself, ki, why does he need to practice, you know? Mm-hmm. And of course, I can't question him so bluntly. But I looked at him, and he was a very, very sharp man. He looked at my face and he knew. He said, "I have to practice more than what I did before, because I have to continue doing what I have done and who I am." So, and I still remember, I'll never forget that. He said, "My life is at stake. I can't be sitting watching TV." So he says, "But I don't want to miss the serial." And that trip itself, he had brought a video cassette recorder from America. He says, "Ami cassettes enechi, notun cassette ache, tumi etake record e diye dao. And go bring your sitar, amra reyaz korbo. Ar tarpor phire eshe Bombay theke, then we'll watch. Toto din onek jama hoye jabe, we'll see it." So I said, "Wow, great." So I put it on there, and anyway, amra Bombay galam, and this is the night, the morning to the concert, that evening before. Anindada was on tabla. Anindada came home. Guruji practiced that whole evening. And that whole trip to Joshi Puraji's house was just practice, practice, practice. Night about 9:15. And Guruji was always very particular about his time. He was very punctual, very much on time. His lunch would be on time. Tumi ghodi milate parbe. Lunch means it's 1:15. Dinner means 9:30. You can. So হি হ্যাড অনিন্দ্রদা 3 ঘন্টা, তো গুরুজি বললো তুমি এত সময় এসে যাও কালকে, আমরা সাউন্ড চেক একটু আর্লি করবো, করে দেন অ্যান্ড গুরুজি কেপ্ট অন সেইং কি আই হোপ দের ইজ অ্যান অডিয়েন্স টুমর, আই হোপ। সো 9:30 উই হ্যাড ডিনার, ডিনারের পরে হি স্যাট আগেন। So naturally, when he's playing, my mind is totally there. I cannot do anything else. This is from day one, Ram. When I heard him play, there something would happen to me. And I would not want to miss a note. Amar kache
Satyajit Ray gupi gan baga hoyner moto stops stand still hoye jeto rokom
garite jacchi uni gaichen sunrise hocche bhairav shekachen garite I would immediately on a tissue paper or whatever I would write down so many or he would say na amake dao ami likhe dicchi so I would not miss it so around 10:30 he said ki Gaurav sokale 4 o'clock you have to wake up because guruji wanted to first go to the siddhi vinayak temple have a darshan and then go to the hall for sound check so he says amader early rise ache tumi shue poro to very reluctantly I went around 10:30 11 o'clock guruji was still playing so I mean he
was playing alone
he was alone it was only me and him so I left my door open and I could hear him and then I don't know when I slept around 12:30 I woke up to go to the bathroom I woke up he was still playing wow. And finally I came back I stood at the door heard him he was just kapur lagiye riyaz korchilen and sokale I woke up early because I wanted to be ready before him have a bath I woke up at about 3:30 he was still practicing anyway so
dada can I ask one thing
maybe, I mean let me finish this because it's such a connect with everything what happened that day so we go then to the Siddhi Vinayak temple he was always very before a concert he was always very nervous let me put it very bluntly he was very nervous he was always very and for him that prayer to his guru prayer to his almighty it was very important so had a darshan and then we went for sound check that day in the concert there were at least if you ask Satish Vyas he'll tell you there was at least 500 people went back home without ticket
oh.
500 at least 500 people hall was packed to the I mean there were people sitting on stage it was like also Guruji was very happy of course but very surprised as well so he started that day he played Parameshwari because I had requested and anytime I would always go I said I want to hear this I want to hear so and he never said no that's such an amazing thing about him that even that day on stage I after the first rag he wanted to play Bhatiyar after Parameshwari and I said if you can I would really love if you can play Yamani Bilawal and he says my god you and your request okay let me see and he played Yamani Bilawal so he started his rag he says I am so very happy to see all of you and I'm so touched that you left Ramayan and have come to listen to me but I know why you have come because all of you have put it on record like I have in Delhi so that you can go back and watch because none of you would like to miss Ramayan you know so but I'm nevertheless I'm very very and what a almost five and a half hours concert that was Ram
wow
Parameshwari Yamani Bilawal Bhatiyar Sindhu Bhairavi ekhono amar kane ekhono oi tanpura bacche because I was on the tanpura amar ekhono bacche amar ekhono and the way he tuned his sitar the way he the whole approach was as if a man is going to worship some priest is getting into a temple er dorja khulche porishkar korche okhane dhup jalacche chan kore sundor sada ka and he was wearing white kurta white dhoti that day and he looked like a priest always whenever he wore white and he wore a dhoti he looked like you know tika lagiye it was an experience it's just I cannot explain you Ram this experience I can only speak but what I feel I still feel that as if it was just yesterday
yeah I can imagine yeah
and another thing Because we were staying with Joshipuraji, and Joshipuraji, they were Gujaratis, vegetarian. Guruji amake prepare kore niye gechilo, mach mangsho pabe na okhane, so don't. So I said, no issues. So he says, but after that concert, the next concert was in New Bombay. So we stayed 1 week in Joshipuraji's house, that concert, and then we drove to New Bombay for the second concert. Okhane, I had requested Guruji to play Darbari. Because Darbari was one rag Guruji always would say, amar ei ragta bishon bhoy kore. Because it's such a mammoth, you know, deity that to approach. And there were few rags Guruji always believed should be played at home for practice for your sadhana. One was Bhairav, one was Darbari. So that day, but he like I always asked, and Guruji, he played Darbari that day. So on the way, he had told me, jokhon jabo, rasta ekta jayga ache. And New Bombay te chilo, we crossed Rarke Studios and we went. And there was a dhaba, Guruji stopped there and he ordered, I still remember he ordered tandoori chicken for me. And when it came, the first piece he took and he put in my plate and he says, I had promised you non-veg after staying 1 week in Joshipuraji's house. And and then that evening was an outstanding, another four and a half hours. And again with Anindada, Darbari, Adana, and I think Vishwapilu.
We will listen to his Darbari maybe to couple of minutes.
That's why I sent it, because there is one thing about his which also Guruji mentioned every time he would teach us, Bhairav, Bhairavi, Darbari, that all rags should not be and cannot be treated in the same way. Like Shuddha Bhairavi is tumar maer roop hoche. You would not want to see your ma with lipstick and, you know, all those things. So simplicity ragbe rage. Darbari is not for taan. Tar jonnei adana toiri hoyeche je adanate ekhon darbari niye tumi jodi taan shuru kore dile, where is the ati komal ga, ati komal dhaivat, ati komal je andolit amra boli taanete ki kore, how is it possible?
But the one thing I am little curious from the past conversation, as you said, he was doing riyaz till late night, right?
And early morning. Till early morning.
So what he used to practice or what he was practicing?
Everything, bowls, he would practice mead, he would practice alap, he would practice everything.
Kind of technical practice in terms of...
I think he was, Ram, at that day's practice with Anindoda, he must have noticed few areas where he needed to work. And after everybody left, he put cloth and he was working on those things where he thought, okay, eta ketu aro porishkar korte hobe.
Just on the need of on that particular day, as he realized, yeah. But generally, when you have seen him practicing, what he used to practice in general, if not in that of that particular day when he used to do his riyaz.
Amader ghorer je talim hoche, first thing what we practice in any rag is chalan. So he would pick a rag and he would do chalans of that. আমাদেরও শেখাতেন, নিজে ওটাই রেয়াজ করতেন, এমন নয় কি আমাদের কিছু বলে হি বুড। সো আমরা যদি দরবারি করছি, ও দরবারি তো আমাদের কয়েকটা চালান দিয়ে উনিও রেয়াজ করতেন। সো হি উড গো, দ্যাট উড বি হিজ প্রসেস। তারপরে ওটা করে হি উড প্র্যাকটিস সাম বোলস অর হোয়াট এভার, দেন হি উড প্র্যাকটিস আ বন্দেশ।
ইউ মিন বোল মিন্স রাইট হ্যান্ড মুভমেন্টস, রাইট? বোল রাইট হ্যান্ড মুভমেন্টস মোস্টলি
উইথ লেফট হ্যান্ড। আমাদের তো রাইট লেফট হ্যান্ড উইথ জামজামা, এন্ড গুরুজির জামজামা ওয়াজ আউটস্ট্যান্ডিং। সো হি উড ডু বোথ হ্যান্ডস প্র্যাকটিস করে তারপরে দেন হি উড দ্য লাস্ট হি উড কাম টু ইজ আলাপ। তারপরে ওই আলাপের মধ্যে ওয়ান্স আলাপটা তোমার তালিম হয়ে গেল ওনার সাথে, মানে ইউ পুট একটা ওটাকে ক্লোজার দিয়ে দাও কি তুমি রাগটা এখন তুমি পেয়ে গেছো, এখন এটাকে নিয়ে মারো রেয়াজ গিয়ে। সো দ্যাট ওয়াজ দ্য
ওয়ান্ডারফুল। সো লেট আস লিসেন টু হিজ দরবারি আ লিটল বিট, এন্ড প্রবাবলি উই আর অল আই মিন Once we talk about these grades, you know, time passes like this.
I can go on till next year, 7th April.
So, definitely, we have to save some for our next episodes also, sure, with you. So sure, we will
definitely.
We will listen to his Darbari. As you mentioned that he played Darbari in Navi Mumbai a little bit, then probably we'll take some topics before we conclude.
Sure.
राग दरबारी से शुरू कर रहा हूँ, आलाप जोर झाला, उसके बाद देखेंगे क्या मालूम नहीं। राग दरबारी।
This is the toughest task, you know, for me.
I know.
To stop any such great recordings in the middle, that is such a difficult task.
Suno por air kharaj panchame ja alapuni. Just listen to it later on.
No, I have listened to this particular darbari mostly, you know, whatever Subrata, I think Chaudhary, he uploaded lot of old recordings from early 50s, mid 50s, you know, early 60s.
They're all masterpieces. Gems. Absolutely.
One Puriya is there, such a beautiful recording.
All of them are just bolo.
Dada, we are already crossed 1 hour, but nevertheless, before we conclude, anything you would like to share, and then we will conclude our session with his beautiful Sindhu Bhairavi, which you have shared with us. So anything you would like to share?
So much to talk about him, but I would seek his
blessings. Today.
I would seek his blessings. I would say that I will give the rest of my life to becoming a good student of his and practicing all what he has taught, and whatever little I know to give it to everybody who's interested in this music. And I take this music very seriously, and I have a lot of disciples. I also teach at the Ravi Shankar Center, Delhi, and there are some very, very good promising students who are learning this music, who are very serious, dedicated. So I want to take his blessings in continuing what I am doing and what he wants me to do.
That's a wonderful message. And I think words of the true devotee and a true disciple. My Guru Maharaj used to say that, my spiritual Gurudev used to say that, the way Bharat used to run Ayodhya in absence of Ram. That is the true way to, you know, lead life. So yeah. I think your words are vibrating in the same line. And for our audience, because the purpose of this hosting these sessions through ICMC channel platform was that, as I was telling you yesterday, our initial thought process was there were so great, great musicians we had in our classical music. But all of us, many of us, our next generation, we have seen these great maestros in front of our eyes. You have seen more, you know, even your seniors have seen even more, like Deepak Jethu and others. Our next generations will not get chance to understand or hear the first-hand experience, that the way you have interacted with them, what was their way of life, how they have lived music, not they have done just done music, they have lived music, and what was their thought process, what was their, you know. So if you could just share some message for our next generation, so that they can learn something in nutshell, in brief, from Panditji's life and vision and his teaching, so that we all of us get inspired, our viewers get inspired. And
I like to, music is there. I like to take a different approach, you know. I don't believe that the next generation has lost out on anything, because these great musicians, in this case today we are talking about Guruji and music, they became one. Whoever does this music with full dedication and hard work, they will see Guruji, they will feel him. He is still here. He is with us. He is not gone anywhere. And believe me, I am not saying it just out of a emotional drive or whatever. I'm just saying it because I have felt it. Whenever I have needed him, he's there. Even in my dreams, in my sleep, if I am stuck with a composition, if I'm stuck with a rag, I have got answers. He's there. He's helping us. He's teaching us. This music, in the end, Ram, it's all about energy. It's not about this flesh and bones. The flesh and bones was not what Pandit Ravi Shankar was. He was who the soul was. So, and the soul never dies. The soul is there. And if you sit in a room and worship the sitar, you play this music, you play 18 hours, your fingers are bleeding, your hands is... I have seen Guruji play with this, both this mark on his right hand with full white pus. Oh. And where you are sitting in Hyderabad, his concert, January 1989, his pus, and five and a half hours with Kumar Daun tabla. Every half an hour, 40 minutes, he's opening the mijrab and he's wiping his pus with, and putting again and playing with the same vigor. If you have that zeal, if you have that drive, if you have this love, passion, you will see him, you will meet him, whoever it is. But the effort will be more of, for us, it was easier. You go ring the bell, like once I remember in 86 when Guruji had his first bout of angina, we were resting in the afternoon. Guruji was in the National Heart Institute just for a checkup. And the bell rang and we opened, it was Ustad Vilayat Khasab. দুপুরবেলা সময় ছিল গুরুজি. Can that happen again? Of course it can happen again. Can you see Ustad Vilayat Khasab? Yes, you can. Effort will be much. Hmm. It will be not as easy as what, but can people? Of course. Tumi bolo na, Vilayat Khasab oi yaman ta jodi keu shunbe, shotti chok bondho kore. You will see that man standing in front of you.
Right. So that's what my point was, like his music is there to convey his message, but the first hand experience, the interactions, the way...
Luckily, Guruji is a musician, he's an artist, he's a person who has been written about so much, who has written also so much. So if you read about him, if you read Raag Anurag, if you read Ragmala, if you read his The Indian Sun, his biography, which was released on his centenary, if you listen to his recordings, interviews, you will see that man. He's there. He is going to be there forever. Mohammad Rafi, you listen to him every day. I listen to him. Lata Mangeshkar, you listen. Are these people gone? No. No.
So, but at the same time, we need you also. People like you who have stayed with them, spend time with them, learn from them, and to convey your personal connects with them. So that will even enrich us.
Absolutely. And it is like this, Ram. From the lamp of his soul, he gave light to so many disciples. So many now it's the time of the disciples to light other lamps. But the source is him.
Source is
Baba.
As Pandit Arvind Parikh says in the same way that he treats himself as the postman of Khansab. So he letters are given by Khansab and he's just distributing the letters to his disciples.
So they're all there with us. They are all guiding us. They are all you will see them. You close your room dark kore dao tumi. You play that Yaman Bandish for 6 hours. I promise you will hear and see Vilayat Khansab.
No.
It's not possible. Life, music without, how can you imagine music without these people? It's possible. Okay. It's not possible.
That's true.
How can I think of the music world without Pandit Ravi Shankar? How can I think my life without Parameshwari? How is it possible? It's not. So they are there. I want to feel happy when I think of him. I want to feel light. I want to feel positive. And not once do I think that, because the day, this is a real story, Ram. I was in America before I was going to London, because that time I was working with the orchestra there. I was the conductor and composer for that. And then I was returning to India for the winter season. And I got a call from Chinama. That year, Guruji had really a lot of heart. So, what are you doing? I said, I'm leaving tomorrow, is my flight. He says, don't you want to come here? Want to see Guruji? I said, yeah, I will come back. Because for me to think that these Guruji is going to leave one day, it didn't even occur to me. Because every time he fell sick, it was really big. He came back. And he came back with the sitar, with practicing hours and performing. So for me I said, I'll come back. She said, no, if come and meet him now. Says, okay. So I went and I stayed there for about a week, 10 days with him in San Diego. This is just December 12th and must have gone October, November. So then I came back, I went to London. London, the day I arrived in Delhi, I reach home and my wife opens the door, early morning, Air India flight, Nichalam. She said, have you heard something? I said, nah. He says, I got a call from a friend, Guruji Bodhai, and she didn't complete it. I said, kichwa ni, because whenever I go back to India, my thing is I go home, have a shower, and I whatever time it is, I have to have an Indian meal. That's my, whether it's barota, ratti re, dupus. I said, give me a, and that whole day, slowly, I made a call to somebody very close in San Diego, and it took a while for that news to hit me, because for me, these people, they are not leaving. They don't. And believe me, I still believe that he's there. And you will hear it. Two pieces, last tumi shesh koro, and you will, I can prove to you he is there. Ekta tumi Anuradhar ganta chaliye dao ektu khani, and last Bhairavi ta lagi dao, and rest is history. Right. Ravi Shankar is immortal. He was there. He will be there. Shashwat bole na, amader Vedanta te. In log sab endless hai. Inka kahan se shuru hua nahi pata chalega, kahan khatam hua nahi pata chalega.
So this, with these wonderful words and lesson for all of us, we will conclude this session with his beautiful creation on from Anuradha, and then we will play his.
Thank you very much for doing this wonderful work and playing so beautifully. I really enjoy what you're doing, and God bless you. And thank you for inviting me to pay my tribute to my great guru.
Thank you so much. We are privileged and blessed to have you.
My pleasure. Thank you.
Thank you.
Now we'll listen to Panditji Sindhu Vairavi.
Thank you.
With this beautiful music piece, heavenly music piece, let us conclude today's session. Pranam to Pandit ji, pranam to you, Dada, and our gratitude to all the viewers we had throughout the session. And this session will be there in ICMC page, and we will share this in ICMC YouTube channel for everyone to listen to it. And this is not for enjoyment, this is for learning for all of us. Pranam. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Bless.